Good morning, First Assembly. Let's all stand together in the house of the Lord on this day of worship. Can we put our hands together all over the room if you're glad to be with God and with His people? Hallelujah. Come on, you can do a little better. Here we go now. That you are God, you are great and greatly to be praised.
Maker of heaven and earth.
into your presence.
But your name.
yes. Oh, yes, Jesus' name above all names. Name above all names. Whom have I in heaven but thee? Nobody like you, Lord. Nobody like you, Lord. Go straight to Psalm 100 and sing with us this morning. How wonderful it is to enter into his gates with thanksgiving. Shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth. Come worshiping before the throne of God. For the Lord, he is good, and his love endures forever. Here we go.
Sweet to into his gates, bringing words of praise and offerings of thanksgiving.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. Oh, hallelujah, there is none like you. Oh, no one else can touch my heart like you do. And I could search for all eternity long and find there is none. I want to say that again. If you believe it, give Him praise this morning. If you believe it, give Him worship. Hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
As we pray this morning, we want to remember Becca Boyce in our prayers. Texted Pastor Dennis this morning just to see how she was doing, and he says she's doing better, but let's pray for no infections, no infection to set in where they've done the surgery. So let's pray for Becca this morning. Also, had a couple of special requests that come in to us. Peyton Long, who was a former Royal Ranger here with us, he was in a serious accident. And he's damaged his liver, and he's in critical condition. Right now he's on a ventilator, and by all the reports that I have received, he's really in a very challenging situation this morning. And there's some decisions that are having to be made. So let's lift up Peyton Long in our prayers this morning and pray for him, for God to touch him. He's in ICU in Charlotte, and we just pray that God would just touch him this morning. Also, Jason Bell, this is Ethan Bell's father. He's got cancer in his throat, and they've asked that we pray for Jason this morning as well. So as we go to the Lord in prayer, because we know that He is able, let's just believe in ask God to touch these that are in need this morning. Amen. Father, we just thank You, God, because we know that there is no one like You. There is no one like You, Lord. You stand separated from all others. Lord, there is no one who rivals who You are. Your greatness, Your love, Your grace, Your healing power. Lord, You stand alone in Your greatness. And Lord, we just ask that You would touch these that we have mentioned this morning, Lord, and bring healing to their bodies. We pray for Becca this morning. Lord, we just pray, God, that You will continue to move in her body. And Lord, that You'll just continue to bring healing and restoration to this body. Lord, we come against any infection right now in the name of Jesus, Lord. We pray that no infection would come into this body right now in Jesus' name, Lord, but that You will just keep her safe. Lord, that You'll continue to do a work of healing, restoring that area. And Lord, that You'll just cause her, Lord, to know Your touch even on her body right now, God, that she would just know Your embrace upon her today. And we thank You for it. Father, we pray for Peyton Long. Lord, we know that that he's in a serious situation this morning, Lord, we pray in the name of Jesus that you would move into that hospital room right there where he's at, that ICU room, Lord, that you'll bring healing to this liver in the name of Jesus, Lord, where this liver has been damaged. Father, we pray in Jesus' name that you will repair this liver right now in Jesus' name, Lord. Let this be a miracle, Father, that will take place in his life, Lord, that will cause even those that are attending him right now, Lord, to just to be in awe of what you have done. We thank you for it today, God. Father, we pray for Jason Bale. And Lord, we just pray that you will just minister healing to his body also in Jesus' name, God. He has this diagnosis of cancer. We rebuke cancer in Jason's body in the name of Jesus. And we just pray healing power to move into his body right now in Jesus' name. Lord, in all of these, Lord, we pray that you will be glorified, that you will be lifted up, because we will know, Father, that you are the one that has done this miracle, that you have brought this about. And we thank you for it today, God. We pray, Father, you'll move throughout this congregation, Lord. Meet every need in this place today, I pray in Jesus' name. Lord, touch us, God, in the place where we need you, Father. Give us answers. Give us direction, Lord. Bring healing to our bodies today. We thank you for it. We give you praise for it today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated this morning. We want to continue to worship the Lord this morning in the giving of our tithes and offerings, and if our ushers will come to receive those gifts. As they're coming, let me just let you know that as soon as we have finished our prayer for the offering, you'll see a video that's going to come up. It's actually leading into BGNC offering for next week, but just wanted to give you the heads up on that so you won't, you know, be totally, you know, shocked and taken back by it, because it's a BGMC video. It's fast moving. So, but let's pray for the offering this morning. Father, we thank you for your blessings to our lives, Lord. We know that every perfect gift comes down from the Father of light. Father, we know that you have blessed us in so many ways. And Lord, we just bring back to you these gifts today, God. We lay them before you, Lord, and we just pray, Father, that you'll bless them. God, we pray that you will take them, multiply them, and use them, Lord. God, we pray that your kingdom will grow because of the gifts and the faithfulness of your people today, God. Thank you for their obedience to you. And Lord, we just give you praise for it today. Bless those that give. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Well, it was supposed to be loud and fast moving, but... We're having some audio problems. Can we re-cue that and try that again in just a little bit? Yeah, let's see if we can't get audio to that. Few announcements while they're working on that. You may have noticed as you came in, there's a display of artwork in the foyer, and that is the stars. Our stars have completed their art unit, and they have just put their artwork on display there in the foyer, so you may want to go by and just take a look at it and see what all they've done. And also, I know this is a ways off, but just wanted to give you a heads up. We will be having a Speed to Light BGMC Next Gen Ministries Golf Tournament on April the 18th. So just kind of save that date. If you're a golfer and would love to be involved in helping us to raise money for Speed Light and BGMC, just put that date, April the 18th, on your calendar. We'll be having a golf tournament at Kings Mountain Country Club, and we'll get back with you on some details of that, but just wanted to give that to you ahead of time so you can go ahead and make plans for that. And also, do we feel like we got the video? Let's go ahead and give that another shot. I don't think we're going to get audio on this. So for those of you who cannot read lips, Let me just let you know that our kids will be in the foyer next Sunday. Next Sunday, they'll be taking a special BGMC offering. They're going to be out in the foyer with their buddy barrels. And so when you leave the next Sunday, they're going to be out there ready to receive from you your offering, your contributions to BGMC. It'll be a way of us helping to raise money for our boys and girls missionary campaign. And BGMC does so much to help our missionaries. And so I know that we all want to be involved in helping our missionaries. So giving you a heads up, next Sunday, they're going to be in the foyer. We may get the video running next Sunday with audio. So we want to look forward to that as well. Thank you so much, Pastor Durbin.
Well, good morning again. Good morning again. And Jeremy, I promise you, yesterday morning, I did not know when you asked me that question you asked me. But here we are. what a great day to be in the house of the Lord. And I realize I just left a bunch of you in the dark, but you're just going to have to embrace the darkness this morning. I want to say a big thank you to Pastor Dennis for extending the invitation for me to preach today. And he just wanted me to be sure and thank you for all of your support and your love. Becca's improving, and he just wanted to be with her today. And so just wanted me to relay that to you. They love you. And Pastor Dennis and Becca, we love you. This congregation loves you. And we're, amen, 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 amen. What a great day. What a great day to be in the Lord's house. And I asked Michael to help me at the beginning and at the end of today's message. And I'm going to need something for the end, so pardon me while I make sure I have what I need for the end of the service. But, man, how many of you appreciate Michael? What a blessing. What a blessing. He has that David anointing. He comes in here sometimes on Tuesday nights before a rehearsal, and he's probably very uncomfortable right now that I'm saying all of this, but he comes in here sometimes and he just sits down to play, and I just feel the peace of God wash over me. And he has that anointing and that touch, just like David did when Saul was troubled in his heart. And so I've asked him to help me at the beginning today. And I want to just jump right in. I'm probably going to preach a little, sing a little, preach a little, and sing a little more today during this message. But it's what's on my heart. I shared this with our music team probably a year or so ago or more. The year was 1866, and in a log cabin in the little town of Franklin, Kentucky, a man by the name of Thomas Obadiah Chisholm was born. He never went to high school or college, but he became an elementary school teacher at the age of 16. 5 years later, he was named the associate editor of the Franklin Favorite, the local newspaper. When he was 27, he attended a revival service led by Dr. H.C. Morrison, and he gave his heart to Christ. He served as a Methodist minister for a short time, and later he was an insurance agent. He went on to live in Winona Lake, Indiana, and also Vineland, New Jersey. He was never in good health. In fact, for much of his life, he would have been considered an invalid. During his lifetime, he wrote over 1,200 poems. And in 1923, he sent a batch of poems to William Runyon, who was a musician serving at Moody Bible Institute in Chicago. And on a trip to Baldwin, Kansas, Mr. Runyon read several of those poems, and one of them so reached out to him, impressed him, gripped his heart, he decided to set it to music. He published it privately, having no idea that it would become one of the most beloved hymns of the 20th century. In 1954, George Beverly Shea introduced it to Great Britain during the Billy Graham Crusade at Haringey Arena in London. And later in his life, Thomas Obadiah Chisholm wrote these words of personal testimony. He said, "My income has not been large at any time due to impaired health in my earlier years, which has followed me until now. However, I must not fail to record here the unfailing faithfulness of a covenant-keeping God, and that He has given me many wonderful displays of His providing care, for which I am filled with astonishing gratefulness." Astonishing gratefulness. That should be the testimony of every believer. And the words that he wrote and sent in that poem to William Runyon, remember, a man who never made enough money, a man who was in ill health almost all of his life, sent these words that William Runyon put to music. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning
with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. If it's your testimony, sing it. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, to me. Summer and winter, and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love.
Can we go up to F?
Pardon for sin and a strength that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine.
Let me stop right there and remind you, he never had enough money. He was in ill health all of his life, but he said, blessings all mine, with 10,000 beside. Come on.
Great is thy faithfulness.
Sing it out.
Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. Great is thy faith.
Come on, say that again.
Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Am I singing and speaking to anybody in this room that knows that he is faithful? Come on, am I singing and speaking to anybody that knows he is faithful? Thank you, Michael. Thank you. I must not fail to record here the unfailing faithfulness of a covenant-keeping God, and that he has given me many
wonderful displays of his providing care, for which I am filled with astonishing gratefulness. I didn't know I was going to be affected this way, but I don't apologize for it this morning. See, this beloved hymn, which has so encouraged God's people, is based on a text that was written during one of, if not the lowest moment in Israel's history. If you know what the word lament means, then you know what Lamentations is all about. Written by Jeremiah as he sat amid the ashes of a destroyed Jerusalem. His mood is bleak. His words are dark and even angry. His tone is one of near total despair. For most of the book of Lamentations, there is not one word of hope, not one ray of light. If you don't believe me, let's read. I'm not even going to touch chapter 1 and chapter 2, but let's start, and we're going to take our time. Let's start. I'm reading from the Amplified Bible in Lamentations chapter 3 and verse 1. This is how the beginning of this chapter reads. I am Jeremiah, the man who has seen affliction because of the rod of his wrath. He has led me and made me walk in darkness and not in light. Surely he has turned his hand against me repeatedly all the day. He has caused my flesh and my skin to waste away. He has shattered my bones. He has besieged and surrounded me with bitterness and hardship. He has made me live in dark places like those who have long been dead. He walled me in so that I cannot get out. He has weighted down my chain. Even when I cry out and shout for help, he shuts out my prayer. How's that for honesty? How is that for just opening your mouth and putting it all on the table before the Lord? He's blocked my ways with cut stone. He made my paths crooked. He is to me like a bear lying in wait and like a lion hiding in secret places. He's turned aside my ways and torn me in pieces. He has made me desolate. He has bent his bow and set me as a target for the arrow. He has caused the arrows of his quiver to enter my inner parts. I've become the object of ridicule to all my people and the subject of their mocking song all the day. He has filled me with bitterness. He made me drunk with wormwood, bitterness. He's broken my teeth with gravel. He's covered me with ashes and made me cower in the dust. My soul has been cast far away from peace. I have forgotten happiness. And so I say, my strength has perished, and so has my hope and expectation from the Lord. Unbelievable words by the man known as the weeping prophet. Remember, O Lord, my affliction and my wandering, the wormwood and the gall, bitterness. My soul continually remembers them and is bowed down within me. But here comes the shift. But this I call to mind, therefore I have hope. It is because of the Lord's loving kindnesses that we are not consumed. Because his tender compassions never fail. They are new every morning. And this is how the Amplified says it: great and beyond measure is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion and my inheritance, says my soul. Therefore, I have hope in him and wait expectantly for him. The Lord is good to those who wait confidently for him, to those who seek him on the authority of God's word. It is good that one waits quietly for the salvation of the Lord. Almost three chapters with not one word of hope or one ray of light. Can I tell you, it's one thing to sing "Great is Your Faithfulness" when our children graduate from high school or college. It's more difficult to sing "Great is Your Faithfulness" when your children announce that they've left the Christian faith. We gladly sing it when the operation is a success. But can we sing it when the treatment doesn't work? Can we sing it when we don't get the outcome that we wanted? This text is not an answer. Hear this statement. This text is not an answer to the mysteries of life. It's not a detailed statement involving intricate theology. This text right here is a word about the nature and the character of our God. It is a word about who God is. This text says that he is our hope in the middle of hopelessness. He is the light in the midst of darkness. He is the way. When we can seem to find no way, He's our reason for going on. When we felt like giving up, there's four things. Don't let that scare you. There's four things I want us to take away from those two verses of Scripture. Those two verses of Scripture. Jake, can you go back to verse 22 and verse 23? It is because of the Lord's loving kindnesses that we are not consumed, because His tender compassions never fail. And verse 23, they are new every morning, great and beyond measure is your faithfulness. You ever ask the question, why am I still here? Have you ever asked the question, why hasn't God done away with me? Why am I still here? What a question. We introduced a song a few weeks ago, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire time after time. And you know what? He's been your fourth man in the fire when you didn't even know about it. There's countless instances that you can talk about, but He's been your fourth man in the fire on occasion after occasion when you didn't know about it. Why am I still here? That verse answers that question. It is because of the Lord's loving kindnesses that we are not consumed. It's because of His loving kindness that we are not consumed. I'm not trying to be melancholic or morbid this morning, but a car could have swerved in front of you on the way to church this morning. A tiny switch could malfunction and the plane could crash. The brakes could give way. A lightning flash could do something catastrophic and deadly in a moment. Who can understand these mysteries? Why are we alive today? It is because of the Lord's loving kindnesses that we are not consumed. Can I tell you a personal story? 1983. My wife and I had been married about 18 months. And I was in Lorain, Ohio, preaching for my lifelong mentor and friend, Johnny Wade Sloan. He had a youth retreat on Memorial Day weekend called Camp Blessing. And I was preaching that camp in 1983. I was 19 years old on Memorial Day weekend. Our daughter Charity would be born about 6 weeks later on July the 9th. So my wife was much with child the end of May of 1983. And the weather was wet and rainy, and you've heard me tell the story about us traveling in the 35-foot fifth wheel, Country Air fifth wheel. And it was Monday after the camp was over, and we were hooking the fifth wheel up to the truck and getting ready to go to our next meeting. It was wet, still rainy. And because of where we parked, had to park the fifth wheel. I could not get the locking mechanism of the fifth wheel to engage with the hitch in the truck. And I worked with it. I kept putting it in reverse slightly, going forward with my foot on the brake, and just trying everything I could to get it to lock and engage, and it wouldn't. And being young and dumb, I asked my wife to move over to the driver's seat, and this is not about anything she did. I want to make that clear. I'm telling you, it was me being young and dumb, not her. But she moved over, and I'm back there with my arm and at times my shoulder and part of my head between the fifth wheel and the bed of that truck, trying to pull that lever and get that tension out so that it would lock and secure. And I couldn't. Still unsuccessful. I worked with it for several minutes with my arm and part of my shoulder and at times part of my head between that fifth wheel and the truck. We couldn't get it. She moved over. I got back in the truck and moved forward, put the truck in drive to try to get that to work. And when I did, that fifth wheel slammed down on the bed of that truck. Minutes before, seconds before, very important parts of my body was underneath that fifth wheel, between the fifth wheel and the truck, trying to get that. We had to crank the fifth wheel back up, get it at the right height, and finally we were able to get it to engage and lock. But it's very, very possible that at 19 years old, and my wife not yet 20, that could have taken me out of here. Why am I still here? It is because of the Lord's loving kindnesses that we are not consumed. All of us. It is because of the Lord's loving kindnesses that we are not consumed. So why am I here? That's the answer. Number two, how do I know that I can count on the love of God? How do I know that God is going to keep on loving me? Because the next line says, because his tender compassions never fail. They never fail. I love the fact that that's plural. He could have said his tender compassion never fails. No, he said his tender compassions, they never fail. James says he gives us more grace. John talks about grace upon grace. In the words of the crusty curmudgeon Andy Rooney, he said, for most of life, nothing wonderful happens. He goes on to say that if you can't find happiness in things like having a cup of coffee with your wife or sitting down to a meal with your family and friends, then you're probably not going to be very happy. If you sit around dreaming about winning the lottery, If you sit around dreaming about when the Yankees are going to call you up to be a starting pitcher, if you sit around dreaming about all the wonderful, amazing things that could happen, you're going to spend most of your days waiting for something that is not going to happen. But I can, on the authority of God's word, tell you this morning that you are profoundly loved and that His tender compassions will never fail. Never fail. Third, when will I get what I need from God? When will God give me what I need? They are new every morning. Every morning. That's a word of hope. God's mercies are new every morning. You know the story about the children of Israel in the Sinai wilderness. Exodus 16 tells about it. They had just crossed the Red Sea. After that great miracle, they started grumbling. They were out in the middle of the desert saying, "Why did you bring us out here? At least we had food in Egypt." And Moses went to God and said, "God, I'm having trouble with these people." God said, "Tell them to get ready. I'm going to provide food for them." And the Lord sent the children of Israel manna and quail. The quail flew in at night. Numbers chapter 11 says the birds were 3 feet deep on the ground in every direction. And in the morning they found dew on the ground, and when the dew disappeared, they found wafers that tasted like crackers with honey, manna. And God's instructions were this: go out and get as much as you need for you and your family, but don't get any more than you need, because if you get more than you need, it's going to rot. It's not going to do you any good. Listen, you don't have to live on yesterday's blessings, and you don't have to be fretful or fearful about what's going to happen tomorrow. God's blessings are never early, but they're not late either. Today's mercies are for today's burdens. When are you going to get what you need? They're new every morning. Every morning. And Michael, you can make your way back. So what's my hope for the future? This is the fourth thing. What is my hope for the future? Why am I still here? It's because the Lord's loving kindness that we're not consumed. How do I know He loves me? His tender compassions never fail. When will I get what I need? They're new every morning. And what is my hope for the future? My hope for the future is, great is your faithfulness. Great is your faithfulness. We may grow weary, but God doesn't. We may give up, but God doesn't. We may vacillate, but God doesn't. We may fail 1,000 times, but God, we've sung 2 songs in the past year. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never, ever fail. And the other one is, Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaken, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. One who's never let me down. He's faithful in every season. So why would He fail now? He won't. He won't. He won't fail. I want to give you one more word from C.S. Lewis, and then I want to go back a lot of years, and I'm going to sing part of a song that all my choir people from 30, 40 years ago, you're going to know it, and you can help me. You can help me when I start. But C.S. Lewis said this. I want you to hear this. C.S. Lewis said, "He who has God and many other things has no more than he who has God alone." He who has God and many other things has no more than he who has God alone. You can trust him today. You can trust him tomorrow. You can trust him. You can say, "Great is your faithfulness," when you just got a check that was unexpected in the mail. But you can say, "Great is your faithfulness," when you've got month left at the end of the money and you don't know how you're going to make ends meet. You can say, "Great is your faithfulness," when you have a job, and you can say, "Great is your faithfulness," when you don't have a job. You can say, "Great is your faithfulness," when everything's going your way, and you can say, "Great is your faithfulness," when nothing is going your way. Here's how the scriptures say it. "I will lift up mine eyes to the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, the Lord which made heaven and earth. He said, He would not suffer thy foot to be moved. The Lord that keepeth thee, he will not slumber nor sleep. Oh, the Lord is thy keeper, the Lord is thy shade. Upon thy right hand, upon thy right hand, no, the sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. He shall preserve thy soul even forevermore." Why do we know it? Why do we know it? Why do we know it? You to stand. I want you to stand right now all over the room. Say it with me. "I will lift up mine eyes to the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, the Lord which made heaven and earth. He said, He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. The Lord that keepeth thee, he will not slumber nor sleep. Oh, the Lord is thy keeper, the Lord is thy shade, and upon thy right hand,
upon thy right hand. No, the sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. He shall preserve thy soul, even forevermore. I want to hear you say, my help, oh my help, oh my help. All of my help cometh from the Lord.
If you have something this morning that you need to give him, physical, financial, relational, spiritual, whatever it may be, I want you to come right now. We're going to lean into this song for a few more minutes. It's only 11:45. You still got plenty of time to beat the other churches to the restaurant. But I want you to come right now. If you have something right now that you need to give him, that you need to trust him with, I want you to come. That's it. Move up just a little bit closer, because in a moment I'm going to ask. You can kneel, you can stand, you can do whatever you need or want to do today to give him that thing. You know, your only help is him. Your only help is him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. C.H. Spurgeon one time said, our tears are liquid prayers. Our tears are liquid prayers. Here's exactly what he said. I want you to hear this. Let us learn to think of tears as liquid prayers, and of weeping as a constant dropping of importunate intercession, which will wear its way surely into the very heart of mercy, despite the stony difficulties which obstruct the way. I want some of the rest of our church to come. And I want us to minister. I want to set you free to minister. You can lay hands on these people, on their shoulder. Stand behind them. Put your hand on their back. Put your hand on their shoulder. And let's pray right now. Everybody that will, let's come and let's minister the help of the Lord. Let's minister the help of the Lord. Let's minister the peace of Christ. I will lift up mine eyes to the hills, whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, the Lord which made heaven and earth. He said, he will not suffer thy foot to be moved. The Lord that keepeth thee, yes, he will not slumber or sleep. Oh, the Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade. And upon thy right hand, upon thy right hand, no, the sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. He shall preserve thy soul, even forevermore. My help, oh, Lord, you're the help for broken hearts. You're the help for struggling people. You're the help for people that will dare to be as honest as Jeremiah was, who say, I pray, but you shut my prayers out. It feels like you shut my prayers out. You're the help for struggling marriages. You're the help for people seeking to find their way. You're the help when we've done all we know to do and we don't know what else to do except to say, my help comes from you, God. And I'll trust in you, my Savior, because you are the one who will never, ever fail. I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and he answered me, and he delivered me from all of my afflictions. I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and he answered me. And it just so happens that I think we're in the right key to go. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Say, I trust in God, my Savior, the one. Trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him, God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Listen, I realize that this started out a little bit different today. And I realize reading Jeremiah's words in Jeremiah chapter 3. If you want more of that, go read chapter 1 and chapter 2. I realized reading his words in chapter 3 until it got to right there. Until it got to right there. It's pretty rough. But can I tell you this morning? We need to learn how to admit and be honest about the bad news so we can experience the good news. God's people, man, we like to shove that stuff under the rug. But if you want to be set free by the good news, you're going to have to learn how to be honest about the bad news. Jeremiah was honest about the bad news. He poured his heart out to God. And God didn't punish him. God didn't reject him. God didn't turn away from him. Jeremiah said, I call this to mind and I have hope. Because of the Lord's loving kindnesses, we're not consumed. Because of his tender compassions, they never fail. They're new every morning, and great and beyond measure is your faithfulness. Lord, you are my portion. You're my inheritance, says my soul. Therefore, I have hope. And I wait expectantly for you. One more time, say, I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my Redeemer.